Hello guys, today I am going to discuss about G protein coupled receptor or GPCR. So this GPCR is also named as serpentine receptor, or it is also known as heptahelical receptor. It is also known as 7 transmembrane domain receptor, and it is also known as G protein linked receptor or GPLR. Okay, this receptor actually involves in transformation of information or information transformation from outside the cell to interior of the cell, causing several cellular response. When it causes several cellular response, it is responsible for giving several type of pharmacological action. If we come to the structure of this G protein coupled receptor, then it consists of 7 membrane spanning hydrophobic amino acid. Here you can see here that this is the G protein coupled receptor, which consists of, I already told you that it consists of the alpha helical membrane spanning hydrophobic amino acid. In other words, the amino acid which have two end, that is one N terminal and other is the C terminal. As we know, amino acid have two terminals are there, one is the N terminal and other one is the C terminal. So N terminal of this alpha helical membrane spanning amino acid present exterior to the membrane. If it is the membrane, then N terminal present exterior to the cell membrane. Whereas the other end or the C terminal present interior to the cell, or it is present in the cytogenic site of the cell. Okay. Then this amino acid crosses the membrane 7 times, like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Like this. So this amino acid crosses the membrane 7 times. That's why this G protein coupled receptor is also called as 7 transmembrane domain receptor. Okay, when this amino acid passes the membrane 7 times, it forms several loops. It means the 3 loops are present, 3 loops are formed outside the cell, and that 3 loops that is present outside the cell is nothing but extracellular loops. In the same way, 3 loops are present inside the cell, and which is called as intracellular loop. And one major thing we need to remember, that the agonist or the stimulating forming agent, that is bind in the extracellular helix of the amino acid. In the extracellular side, in any loop, the agonist can bind. So I am representing here that this side as agonist binding region. In any portion of the extracellular helix, the agonist can bind. And another thing, in the lower loop or in the intracellular loop, there is a region, and that region is called as G protein binding region. So in any portion of this intracellular loop, G protein can bind. So in the other way, you can say that as this G protein binded with this receptor, or this G protein coupled with this receptor, that's why this receptor is also called as G protein coupled receptor. Another important thing we need to know, that this G protein is nothing but a guanine nucleotide binding protein, and this G protein consists of 3 subunits. It consists of 3 subunits, that is alpha, beta and gamma. And this G protein active when it is binding with the GTP, guanosine triphosphate. When it binds with the protein, G protein, then this G protein becomes present in active state. Whereas if this GTP is replaces with GDP or guanosine triphosphate, this G protein becomes inactive. Okay, next one, to how this G protein works. So when any agonist or any stimulating forming agent binding with this particular this agonist binding region, then what will happen? Then the shape of the receptor or the conformation of the receptor changes, which allow the binding of this G protein. And this G protein present in inactive state. It means the G protein combined with this GD. When a stimulating molecule binds with this region or agonist binding region, then the conformation of the receptor changes, which allows binding of a inactive G protein complex into this particular binding region. So after that, when this GTP will replace with GT, when this GTP that is binded to the alpha subunit G protein with GTP, then this G protein becomes activated or the receptor becomes activated. After that, what happens? This alpha unit containing GTP will displace or will dissociate. How? It will dissociate like this from other subunit or the beta unit or gamma subunit that will separate it from the alpha subunit and also from the receptor. It is totally separated out. After that, this alpha subunit containing the GTP combined with other intracellular protein. It will combine with other intracellular protein. Not only this alpha containing GTP subunit combined with intracellular protein, this beta or gamma subunit also combined with intracellular protein to continue signal transduction or transformation of information occur. As a result, it gives several activity or several pharmacological activity may develop. These things happen after removal or after dissociation of this G protein from this receptor. After that, what will happen? This receptor becomes free. There is no attachment of this G protein. So this G protein again is ready to bind with another G protein, and another G protein will bind here. As a result, another signal transduction process will continue. And in this same way, several type of signal transduction activity will generate to produce several type of pharmacological activity. So this is all about G protein coupling. In the next class, we'll discuss some new topics.